Okay, first two takes were duds. Can we get it on the third take? Welcome back to the Life of Birch Mini Moto Garage, aka my living room, where today we finally... Welcome back to the Life of Birch Mini Moto Garage, aka my living room, where we finally continue with the Honda Navi budget build series.
Welcome to the Navi budget build.
Whoa, there's...
If you're new here, my name is Birch, and the whole point of these Honda Navi budget build videos is just to show you guys just how cheap and easy it actually is to not only own a motorcycle, but to also ride it and work on it. The majority of the mods that I've done on both my Navi and my girlfriend's Navi have all cost under $50, and all the work has been so easy that I've done it either in this living room or on the side of a cliff.
I snuck down here because they're doing construction at my condo, and I'm making an install video, and I figured this would be a great view.
The Navi budget build started with my girlfriend's bike, where we did this windscreen, this cup holder, and these saddlebags all off of Amazon, and each of them cost under $50. Then I ended up buying my own Honda Navi, because why wouldn't I? They're $1,800. And we did the $15 Vans grips, and then kicked it up a notch with all of the CVT work in there, which was still relatively cheap. After spending about $340 on all those CVT parts combined, it yielded serious performance results.
This is the best 0-40 and best 0-50 we've ever had.
And then of course we had to kick things back up a notch and do the only costly thing so far, which is this Yoshimura exhaust. This came in at about $480, but it was so worth it. At first I thought it was a bit loud for what this bike is, but I ended up getting the spark arrestor in there and it's the perfect volume now. And now we're bringing it back down a notch with this stack of parts that's only $35 each or less. So today we're installing some handguards here that only cost me $23, then some smoke turn signal covers here, which I'm super stoked on, and these were only $12 a pair. And then the thing I'm most excited for is this upgraded rear shock, which, no, you are not hearing me incorrectly, only costs $35 per shock. All right, so let's kick things off with these fancy smoke turn signal covers. As you can see, the stock turn signal lenses for both the front and the rear are both clear lenses. And then you get the orange bulbs inside, so they illuminate orange. That's all fine and dandy, but the chrome clear look just isn't doing it for me, especially on a bike where most of it is blacked out. So I started thinking, how can I find or make smoked lenses for this bike? After some research, I come to find out that the CBR300R lenses, actually the entire turn signal setup, is the exact same as the Navi. So I figured, you know what? I could probably look for some CBR300 lenses because there's not many mods for the Navi, and that's exactly what I found. So these are entirely new turn signals. We have two pairs here, and they're actually designed for the CBR300, but they should be the exact same thing as the Navi. However, you can see that it comes with the smoked lens. So theoretically, we could replace the entire turn signal setup, but since it's the exact same, I figure why we need to do that, we can just swap out the lenses and make life easier on ourselves. So yeah, it's pretty crazy looking at it. It's literally the exact same turn signal. So hopefully the lenses line up since these are stock and these are aftermarket, but I have high hopes. So to get these covers off, it's literally just two screws on the back of each of them, or I lied. There's one on the back and one on the front. Wait, is that how the stock one is? Yes, okay. I panicked for no reason. So all we're looking at is 8 total screws, and then this thing should be one step closer to being totally blacked out. Dude, it fits perfect and it looks so good. That looks so much better than the clear. Holy crap. Yeah, I'm very pleased, but we're not done yet, obviously. I want to compare how bright they are since I'm sure some of you will be weary about the smoke covers. Did I just now realize that this thing doesn't have hazards, or am I stupid? I guess we'll test it one by one. Okay, so that's how bright it is with the clear, and that's how bright it is with the smoked. Honestly, not much difference. Maybe a little bit of difference, but not enough to make it worth not keeping these on, dude. That looks so freaking good. All right, so I just went to move on to the second one and I noticed something. Can you guys point out what I'm talking about? I'll show you. So one of the reasons that these might be so cheap is because they don't actually have any sort of seal to keep water out, whereas the stock ones have this like rubber seal that goes around it. So I'm gonna try and take the rubber seal off of the stock one and put it on this to see if it works. And if not, it's not a big deal because I don't ride in rain anyway, but if we can have that extra piece peace of mind, it'll be nice. So let's see. All right, so I'm realizing that the easiest way is to actually put the seal in the track there, because it was a bit hard to try and get it on there. And I think it's designed to do it this way anyway. So yeah, you just take the rubber seal and you lay it in that track, and you can see there's even a little opening down there. So if water does get in there, it'll still come out the bottom. And yeah, we should be good to go there. So let's do that for all four and we're good. These look so good. Oh my gosh. I'm sure Nina is definitely gonna come home and see mine and wanna swap hers out, because holy crap, what a difference. Looks so good and it was so easy too. The only thing I can say is that on both of the rear ones, I think I got overzealous and tightened the middle bolt down or screw down too much, and I did hear something crack. But they're on there nice and good, and I don't see anything that's like noticeably cracked, so we should be good. And if that's the only issue that we ran into for some stuff that costs $12 a pair, or as my Scottish girlfriend would say, cheap as chips, innit? Then I'm stoked, because holy damn does that look good. So the $12 a pair smoke turn signals have started us off great. Super impressed by these. Now we're going in order from least doll hairs to most doll hairs, and we're going to the $23 handguards next. Now, in full transparency, I actually got these things back in November when it was much colder than it is now, because I wanted something that would take the wind off of my hands and kind of make it less cold when I was wearing my summer gloves, and I thought that these would do the trick. Now I'm not so sure if we need them, because today is actually the first day of spring, and don't get me wrong, it looks nice and warm, but it is still in the 40s, but things are gonna be warming up soon, so not sure if we actually still need these, but we're gonna give them a try to see if we'll need them for next winter, and they should just mount up real nice right there. Plenty of size to them, so it should block all the wind from our hands and keep us nice and warm when we're wearing summer gloves in the winter like idiots. All right, so these are actually just universal handguards. We have a bunch of different brackets here, but we should be able to make it work with this one. I don't know if we'll need one of the extensions or not, but let's go ahead and start getting this thrown together with the provided hardware and see what we can get to happen.
A few moments later.
Okay, so both of them have the hardware on, but I'm not gonna lie, it's a little bit weird because it doesn't come with like rubber washers. It comes with almost like rubber O-rings. So it's a little weird because if you tighten them down too far, the O-rings start smushing out of the sides. Oh, you can tell here, you can see it like smushing out of the side there. So the O-rings are a little bit weird. I get why they're there for like vibration purposes, but I'll probably end up switching that out for some rubber washers at some point. But for now, we should be good. You know, it's on there nice and tight. The O-rings are weird, but it should work. So how these work is they have a hole right there and they're supposed to just attach right where the mirror does. So it looks like if we just attach it like that, it won't fully cover our hands. It might be like too far down. So we might have to bend the tab up, but we're gonna give it a college try and see how it works out.
Much later.
Okay, so the handguards are on, but that was a lot trickier than I thought it was gonna be, and I'm still not sold on them because I didn't realize until I went to do that, but the hand controls on the Navi bars are actually uneven. So even though I bent them the same way, the handguards aren't in the same place or position. Let me show you and get your opinion. Okay, so I started with the left side and everything was fine with that. It did take me a second to realize how I wanted to get it set up because I did have to bend it up a decent amount here. Before it was like all the way down and like angled kind of like that. So you can see this used to be flat, but I bent it to make it work. I had to do that not only to get it like up and down and actually cover the grip, but also so that I could avoid the parking brake right here. So I'm sure you can tell that before I bent it, this would have hit the handguard. And then also there wasn't room underneath this bracket for the lock part. So I had to get it bent out of the way, and all is well in the world. You still got clearance there for the bolt between there. And then there's still plenty of room for your finger to go in there and activate the parking brake. So it took some bending and finagling, but that side was easy enough. But then I moved on to the other side, and as soon as I put it on, I was like, something is not right here. Welcome home. You don't know what you just walked into.
Not when I brought you cold brew.
Wow, cold brew. Welcome to the Navi budget build.
Whoa, there's hand guards.
Yeah, so perfect timing. Come look at it and tell me if it's just my OCD or if it does actually look stupid. First things first, let's get your reaction. Turn signals.
Ooh! Ah! Yeah, I want those. I want those.
The hand guards, I never noticed on the Navi, the hand controls are uneven. This mounting point is actually like an inch or two further over than this one is. The mirror leg is shorter. As you can see, this... What the f*** was that? Was that the... Oh, sh**. This just cracked and stripped out and popped off. Maybe I tightened it down too much? I don't know. Literally, that just popped out.
That was weird.
But anyway, come sit on it. So if you look at it, this part of the mirror
mm-hmm.
on the left side lines up like halfway through the grip.
Oh, but this one is almost at the end.
Yeah, but this one yeah. comes almost to the end.
Okay.
So I never noticed that it's literally like 1 or 2 inches further out.
Right.
And then also, you can see that this boot totally covers it, and then it has room to spare.
On that one.
It's also like a half inch to an inch higher up because this boot won't go all the way down. So if I bend these brackets the exact same, this one's gonna be higher and further out. Looking at it from the front, this lines up like almost with the bend of the bar, and then this one lines up all the way over here.
Yeah, I can see the height difference sitting here looking at it, but I don't think.
Yeah.
I don't think it's that noticeable.
So two questionable yet cheap mods down, and now it's time to move on to the most expensive one, which is the upgraded rear shock. Hopefully we can tell that it is a true upgrade, unlike the other two so far, where the turn signals look great, but I feel like that crack was a paid actor, the fact that it happened while I was recording. And then the hand guards, which look awesome and should be functional, but they're not even, and I don't know if it's gonna drive my OCD crazy or not. I'm really hoping that these shocks are the answer to my problems, because if you watched any of my Navi reviews before, you know that the rear suspension is one of my biggest gripes. Obviously, it's an $1,800 motorcycle slash scooter, so how good can it be? But it really is super, super firm. So hopefully these bad boys should do the trick. These are the RFY Amazon Universal Specials. Come on, there we go. And I've seen people use these on anything from cafe racer builds to scooters to everything. And from what I've heard, they should be super good bang for the buck upgraded shocks. And the two of these only cost $70. I know I said 35, but you get two of them and you only need one. So in our case, we each get one shock for $35 each. And in your case, you can buy two of them for 70 and then sell one and make half the money back. So it does not get much better than $35 for this fancy upgraded shock with piggyback reservoir. I'm not sure if the piggyback reservoir is real or just for looks, but either way, I think anything will be an upgrade over that. So I'm very, very excited to see how this turns out. Now, removing the stock shock should be pretty simple. You just got one bolt up here and one bolt down there. And then I'd imagine you probably have to undo that bolt to get the fender out of the way to pop it out. But we're actually gonna take it a step further and just totally remove the rear fender. And the reason for that is because I've seen other people run these shocks and they said that this reservoir comes down so far that it hits this right here. So lots of the people who have ran these have ended up kind of like cutting down around there to clear some space for the reservoir. But honestly, I think I just want to take the whole rear fender off because I want to go for the kind of like exposed bobber type look, and it'll save us the troubles of cutting and everything like that. So in addition to taking off the shock, we'll also go ahead and take the fender off, which will mean taking off this little piece of the bracket for the Yoshimura exhaust, and then coming around over here, and there's a couple bolts down here that you got to take off, and we will need to put these back on because they actually help hold this cover on, and if you don't put the bolts back in, a bunch of oil will fly out. And then I don't know if there's any bolts down there or not, but I guess we'll find out. Alright, so everything's all taken apart. That was super simple, took basically no time at all. For the rear fender, it was all of the bolts that I mentioned. However, I did miss a bolt right here. So if you're looking at the bike, the bolt would be down in here, and you gotta make sure to get that one as well. But the weird thing is, the reason why I missed it is because it actually wasn't on my bike. Obviously, you can see that there was the hole where it was supposed to be, but the bolt itself was not there, which makes me question this bike's past life even more. If you're familiar with the channel, you know that when I got it, it had issues, and the more that I dig into it, I keep finding weird stuff like that. So really makes you wonder what happened to this bike. bike before I got it. Now comparing the two shocks, you can see that obviously the new one is all blacked out compared to this, and it just looks like a whole lot higher quality, which is pretty crazy for $35. And then if you sit them side by side, hopefully you guys can tell, it is like maybe a half inch taller than the stock one. But one of the benefits of this is that it's actually preload adjustable as well, so you can thread this collar down to either increase the preload or increase the height, whatever you're looking for. So super stoked on that. I think I have seen some people say that the stock hardware doesn't work the best with this, so we may have to do a hardware store for a different bolt, but we will see. Let's try and get it put back together. As it turns out, the hardware store was indeed needed for a couple of reasons. So first things first, this is the stock bolt inside of the new shock. And as you can see, it's tightened down all the way, but it barely has any thread, actually no thread at all coming out the other side. So we needed to get a longer bolt. And then also, you probably won't be able to tell just yet, but the opening of the new shock is slightly wider, like slightly wider than the stock shock. So not only did we have to get a longer bolt to make up for all of that, but we had to get a couple of washers to put in there so that there's no movement side to side with this. Now, not only that, but as I was looking at it to line everything up, as it turns out, I believe the shock's gonna hit this also, so we'll probably have to cut out a bit of this plastic so it doesn't hit. But other than that, it should be straightforward. After a bit of a fight, she is on and looking so good. When I say it put up a fight, I don't mean that it'll happen for you. I mean, it's really hard for me to do this with one person as I'm trying to film with my knees. But with that said, it is on and good to go. There's a few things that I noted. The first one is that we did have to cut this plastic. As you can see, there used to be a lip that came down here, so I took a Dremel and I cut around that. Once we put it on the ground, there may be a chance that this still hits this plastic and we have to cut up a little bit higher, but we'll see that once we put it down. And then the other thing is down here, it ended up only needing one washer instead of two, and that was kind of the hardest part, was trying to get this bolt through and lined up with the washer and then through the other side with just myself trying to like lift up on the back wheel while lining that up while filming with my knees. But we got it done. One thing I would suggest for this part is removing this little end piece here. It just has a clamp up there that you got to undo, and then the whole thing slides off. That makes it a lot easier to get this bolt in straight to line it up properly. And if you are doing this by yourself, one thing that helped me is I just wedged this stuff underneath the tire to kind of hold it up, so I didn't have to hold the tire all the way up, if that makes sense. Kind of wedge it under there to give some leverage to get it up to line everything up properly. But other than that, I think it's about time to put it on the ground and see if we have any more clearance issues there. But before we do that, I think there's something else we got to do to this so that everything looks proper. That's right, we got the front fender off too, looking so good, matching with the rear. I feel like it just takes away so much busyness of the bike, and I never ride this thing in the rain really anyway, so who cares? Of course, I do off-road it a decent amount, so it might help to have a fender if we go through some mud, but you know, what's the point of going off-roading if you're not getting dirty? So let's get this baby outside and go for a ride. We'll test out the new shock and see how that does, and we'll also test out the handguards and see how much wind protection they offer.
Whether or not these upgrades are actually upgrades is yet to be determined, but damn does it look so freaking good now, dude. And I gotta be honest, if I just saw this on the street, I would never notice that the handguards were uneven, but the turn signals and the lack of fenders just seriously pulls this thing together. And I don't think I ever told you the process for the front fender, but there's literally just on each side, oh god, watch out for the throttle, 3 8-millimeter bolts on each side, and then the fender I pretty much just folded up and pulled through the forks, so easy as pie. I digress, let's get on this thing and see how it rides. I was gonna ease off the curb, but you know what, I don't think I will. Let's test out the shock. Oh my god, dude, that's so much better. Let's go, baby. Also, I don't know if you guys can tell how much quieter the exhaust is, but it is definitely quieter. Still loud as hell, but like the perfect volume, you know? Before, I felt like my neighbors were gonna call the cops on me, and now I feel like they're not. All right, so before coming out, I did adjust the shock because when I took it off the center stand and just sat on it, I could already tell that it was a bit too soft, not enough preload for me. But of course, I forgot that it was like all the way at the lowest preload setting, so of course it's gonna feel that way. Right now, I have it set in about the middle just to get a baseline. So let's mob this and see what happens. Ooh, that felt like it actually bottomed out a little bit. Definitely way, way better than the stock shock, but I think I need to add some preload still. And initial impressions for the handguards are working really well, it seems like. I can still feel air hitting the tops of my hands, but my fingers don't seem to be catching any wind at all. And I feel like your fingers are the first thing to get cold and go numb anyway, so that's nice. From back here, yeah, definitely I feel like bottomed out. I wonder if I can adjust the preload by hand. It seemed like it might be easy enough too. Yeah, that's doing it. It's not doing it well, but it's doing it. So this should be about 3/4 preload, I think. Let's see if this is any better. Just bouncing around on it, it seems like it is. But we got a speed bump coming up here, so let's see. Oh yeah, baby, that's the sweet spot. We're about 3/4 of the way all the way out on preload, and it feels like the sweet spot, and I weigh about 160, I think. Let's hit this. Oh yeah, see, dude? Oh my God, it's so much better than stock. Let's see the turn signals in the kind of sort of dark, but also daylight. Yeah, dude, you can't even notice that they're smoked when they're on. Definitely some more fiddling to do with the shock to get the settings right, but honestly, it's already a huge step ahead of the stock shock as is, so I can only imagine how good it's gonna be once we play around with it and get it how we want. Let's hit it fast. Oh, see, that wasn't bad, dude. That would have destroyed my spine with the stock suspension. But yeah, so there you have it. A nice little multi-modification edition of the Honda Navi budget build. Just goes to show you guys that you don't need a lot of money or a lot of, knowledge to be able to buy a bike and work on it. For a couple $1,000, you got the ultimate hooligan machine. Can we do it? Ooh, that was actually scary, I'm not gonna lie. You guys get the picture. Minimal money, maximum fun. That's what the Navi's all about, and I think that the modifications today prove that. I'm gonna get out of here. Hopefully you guys enjoyed this one, and if you did, make sure to give me a big old thumbs up. Shout out to the Patreon members for making all of this possible. I couldn't be doing this without you guys, and if you wanna sign up for Patreon, check out patreon.com/lifeofbirch, where you can get early access to videos, behind the scenes content, and much, much more. Make sure to subscribe if you haven't already, and we will catch y'all on the next one. Love you guys, peace. Oh, so basic. Hope you play this. Damn, I prayed it. Nice on air. I be canis. Old souls fake it. Pay those placements. Ay, fuck shit. Ay. And I'm still waiting on a brighter day. It's been a minute, been rough many times more. And I'm kicking rocks to a sky of gray. Praying hearts talk to me for I'm done for.